So hello everyone, right now I'm with William Mougayar from Toronto, Canada, who is a famous angel investor in this space, who has invested in lots of interesting companies. We'll be talking about business models and Ethereum. But first, let's have an introduction about your background.
Okay, so I've been in technology for a long time, more than 30 years. But recently, I've been more interested in investments in the space. I am also an entrepreneur. Not too long ago, I founded two companies. I like to blog about the topic and try to explain what the blockchain's impact is from a business perspective. So I try to explain it in non-technical terms. That's been my mission recently. And I'm also on the advisory board for Ethereum and a few other companies involved in the space. Yeah.
So for William's articles, do check up startupmanagement.com.
Or .org.
Startupmanagement.org. And he has a 4,500-word article on Ethereum and its impact on the Ethereum blog. That is quite interesting.
Yes. That one is on the Ethereum blog, actually. Mm-hmm. The business imperative of Ethereum, for Ethereum.
It's called the business imperative behind the Ethereum vision.
That's right.
So let's start off with one question that I think many listeners of ours have. What many listeners perceive is, because the value of the Bitcoin token and Ethereum is very short, Bitcoin is going down. They see this shift in this year where the amount of venture capital raise has also fallen quite a bit. Inside the venture capital and angel investor community, do you think that this technology is having challenges raising funding, or is this a normal part of any technology trend?
Well, I don't think I agree with saying that the investment is going to be down this year. I'm aware of a number of investments that are happening, but that may not be announced. So there's a bit of a lag usually when whoever is adding those statistics so that they can tell us how much money is going on, is happening in terms of investments. There's a delay. And we may not know until early next year what these numbers are, but especially in the capital markets space, blockchain companies going after the trading aspects of the financial services, there's a lot of money being raised in that category. Mm-hmm. And I know for a fact many of these companies will not announce it. At least they would announce it later. So that's a characteristic that's happening right now. And usually at the end of the year, you never know, there's some business that gets done very quickly before the end of December. Mm-hmm. But this is tracking very much what has happened with the internet 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. And about 20 years ago, the investments in the internet space were about $1 billion or so per year. And today, the investments in technology and the internet and anything to do with it is about $60 billion just in North America alone.
Yeah.
So I'm not worried that the investments in the blockchain / Bitcoin space is taking any hits or any slowdowns. It's actually going in the right direction.
It's actually going on. That's quite interesting. So we've had like 5 days at the DevCon where lots of interesting companies came and pitched. And you have been involved in the Ethereum ecosystem for a long time. What are some of the ideas that you find really interesting here?
Well, the main thing about the Ethereum ecosystem, as I was saying in my earlier talk, is that Ethereum is more than just one thing from this point going forward. Maybe it wasn't obvious to everybody, but more and more we are seeing now Ethereum kind of coming out of the foundation itself. So the foundation is one piece of Ethereum. There's also the network. The network is now out. It's in the wild. There are hundreds of nodes running it. So that is another important component. The third component is all of the technologies that make up Ethereum from a development point of view. And some of them have been developed by Ethereum Core and some have been developed by outsiders. That's an important piece. And finally, there's as well all of the partners, the investors, and the stakeholders that are also part of the ecosystem. And the other piece is the clients and the customers. We didn't have a lot of users and customers before. And they make up the other side of the whole ecosystem of Ethereum. So it's really coming out, and this is only the beginning, I think. And we're going to see improvement in each one of these segments specifically in terms of where Ethereum is going.
So in Ethereum, like in the Ethereum ecosystem, we can see many segments emerging, like things that focus on payments, things that focus on, say, gaming on Ethereum, prediction markets on Ethereum. There are things that interface with energy markets. A lot of these different segments are coming. Are there any segments that stand out to you in particular as having potential in a short run, in the short run?
Well, there's a good variety. There's a good variety in terms of where the activity is. The one that got a lot of airplay this week is the financial services. We kept hearing over and over again so many banks getting involved in trying Ethereum technology. I think the part that I have not heard a lot about that I'd like to hear more about, I think it's an area that's very natural, is government services. The topic of anything to do with titles, registries, and all of the government services that already exist today. And if you think about it, a few years ago in the more developed countries, governments have stepped up with e-services, with allowing businesses to register online, allowing us as citizens to file taxes online, and a whole variety of government services have been online. So I think the trust-based services based on Ethereum or other blockchains are a natural evolution of where governments can take their e-services into society and into business. And I'd like to see more activity and more work done in the government services area. And then maybe a bit more in the consumer space. The reason why consumer is interesting, like the games, the gaming, I think somebody is developing Ether Poker, because there is a visibility that happens when a product hits the consumers, then by default it can hit millions of users, so it spreads the footprint more aggressively. Whereas with the enterprises and the businesses, the numbers are smaller, because that's the nature of business to business, and half of them will not tell you what they are doing. So if you've heard of six banks mm-hmm. here this week, I can bet you there's at least 12 that are doing something and not saying mm-hmm. what they are doing.
Yeah. That's really true. And one of the challenges that seem to confront the ecosystem in general of companies is the question of monetization. That ideally we want the logic of a decentralized application to be transparent on the blockchain, and we also want the application to not control any user data. But this creates kind of unique challenges at monetization. What are your thoughts on that?
Yes, I mean, we're still learning. We're still learning and exploring the business models that are going to be viable on top of these new networks, these new protocols, like the Open Bazaar protocol, which is a peer-to-peer e-commerce protocol. And but we shouldn't be fearful of trying to deploy them, because first you have to deploy it, and then you have to get users on it, and then you can learn. You can learn the possibilities only when the users are on it. I mean, in theory, everything makes sense. And the crypto space has a lot of theoretical work behind it, where almost every startup has a white paper behind them, or every company has some kind of theoretical construct behind them. And it makes a lot of sense. But the real test is when it goes on the market. And so I would encourage anybody to just put their product in the market, put their service in the market, and then let the users guide you to where they want to go. And then a lot of innovation will become more obvious and more possible in terms of the business models. I think the business models will come after the deployment. We have to install them, we have to deploy them, and we have to gain some experience in using them. And then we shouldn't be afraid of what we're going to discover after all, after that.
Mm-hmm. So the Ethereum, like as somebody who has been involved in Ethereum and who has influence in the ecosystem, I ask you this question, like you have been involved for a long time, that part of the reason people are kind of a bit worried about Ethereum or not converted to Ethereum yet is that they perceive that Ethereum had this amazing spike in development funding, which was 18 million, and they seem to have spent quite a bit of it and can run the next year the Ethereum Foundation quite safe. But then after that, there is no kind of central funding point at which they can draw to develop the very great ideas that Vitalik and others are coming up with. And on the other side, if you look at the way the Ether tokens are issued, they've gone for a proof of work function that does not have any annual rewards for the Ethereum Foundation at all. And also the proof of work function is also something that kind of is very long lasting. Like unlike Bitcoin that just goes flat out at 21 million, Ethereum tokens will be created for as many years in the future as you can see. So where do you think how will Ethereum as an ecosystem continue to develop its core infrastructure?
Yeah, I mean, you've raised a lot of points here. First of all, I'm not worried about when people say the foundation is going to run out of money. I mean, that seems to be something I hear once in a while, but it's more perception than reality. The first thing I would say is that now the ecosystem is big. So it's not just the foundation that is developing the technology, although they are committed to developing and researching a number of the technologies, but they are not the only ones. And if there is money for a year, this is plenty because we take it 1 year at a time. Let them take it 1 year at a time. And you know, we cannot predict what's going to happen in 1 year. As the technology gets deployed, there will be a lot of opportunities to continue to fund the foundation. There has been supporters that have come in and supported it already out of China, and there's going to be more of that, conceivably speaking. And then Vitalik even said that he's thinking of ways to issue potentially a little bit of Ether, which would form a small inflation part to continue funding the foundation if he has to. So right now, I think the foundation is fine. But it's more than the foundation. And it's really, at the end of the day, it's the people. It's the people that are developing. So in the very, very worst of cases, and I don't want to even speculate that this would happen, even if there was no foundation, the people are still there. And the same people are going to continue to develop on the same things. And that's what matters, really, is to continue to push the envelope on the research, on the development, on the science aspect. And Vitalik and all of the others are committed to it. And that's what counts, really.
Yeah, that was definitely seen on this DevCon. There are like so many for-profit companies that are now invested in Ethereum that conceivably they could also keep contributing to the development of the core protocol.
Exactly. I mean, it's becoming almost a self-sustainable environment. Not 100%, but almost. It's getting there. Mm-hmm. It is going towards that self-sustainable mode, where everything supports it, basically from the bottoms up. And then there's going to be some money coming from the top down as well. A lot of the venture capitalists are very interested about Ethereum. Compared to Bitcoin, it's coming later. I mean, it's only been out in the wild for not even 4 months. Mm-hmm. So it is a fairly, fairly young technology. I think the best days are yet to come.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so in principle, would you support like some kind of maintenance issuance to the Ethereum Foundation that some section of Ether that a small amount of inflation that keeps going to the foundation and helps maintain the core infrastructure that so many people are going to depend on?
I'm not sure I'm in a position or that I would be the right person to answer that question. It's really in the realm of the foundation that for them to decide. And the thing that we have to keep in mind is we don't have to speculate what might happen in a year from now, because the variables and the parameters and the environment and the situation will be different a year from now. The whole thing is advancing almost in dog years. Mm-hmm. Every 3 months, it's almost like a year in terms of development. And they are very close to what's going on. So I think I'm confident that they will make the right decisions at the right times.
Mm-hmm. And in the venture capital and angel investment community, there have been many venture capitalists that have come out vocally in support of Bitcoin and have taken the position that it's the blockchain, with the in bold capital letters. Whereas you have been one of the outliers in that community that has kind of supported Ethereum from early on. Mm. And you have taken a different stance to the other ones. Do you see the stance that Bitcoin is the only game in town softening?
Well, I would correct you slightly on that. I am more of a middle of the road person. Actually, my last three investments are in the Bitcoin space, specifically. Mm-hmm. So I have supported the Bitcoin ecosystem, and I'm also supporting the Ethereum ecosystem almost equally. I mean, I'd like both of them to succeed, and they each have their strengths and weaknesses, and I am more of a proponent of decentralized technologies and decentralized models, peer-to-peer constructs and protocols and networks. And I see Bitcoin and blockchains and Ethereum as applications.
Yeah.
On this trend that hopefully will stay with us for a long time. So the other thing, I mean, I've been telling everybody that we shouldn't say any bad things about each other. Mm-hmm. From either side. I've heard the Bitcoin community say some bad things about Ethereum, and I've heard the Ethereum community say some bad things about Bitcoin. And whenever I hear that, I will remind people that we should not be doing that, because we're all in the same boat. Mm-hmm. And if the ecosystem gets bigger, everybody benefits.
Yeah.
And that's what we should be focused on.
Mm-hmm. Okay, So do you see more other venture capitalists now investing in Ethereum or going? So because like if the assumption is that the Bitcoin is going to be the only blockchain, then any investment on Ethereum is difficult. So this frame of mind, in a sense, needs to be broken, and we need to go to your frame of mind, which is both can survive and coexist.
Absolutely. I mean, I don't want to use the banking examples too many times, but look at the financial services. They did not want to touch Bitcoin, but they are touching the Ethereum blockchain. So to Ethereum's credit, and we don't say it too many times, but we should, I think, as Ethereum, the banks are adopting Ethereum on their own, whereas they wouldn't touch Bitcoin. So that's a big achievement for Ethereum. Bitcoin has good network effects right now because it has a lot of users, but it's not a fair apples to apples comparison, because Ethereum is not going after the payments space.
Yeah.
Ethereum is more a fundamental platform technology, as you know, for developing decentralized applications. And that's the sweet spot of Ethereum. It takes care of a lot of the decentralization features that applications will need. And it makes it easier for developers to develop on the Ethereum platform. I'm not saying developing on Bitcoin let me correct what I said. Developing on Bitcoin is different than developing on Ethereum, let's put it that way. At this point. But there will be a little bit more convergence going into the future. And what's important is to make the ecosystem bigger. And that's what I'm focused on.
Yeah, cool. So where can our listeners find out more about you or your thoughts on this ecosystem?
Sure. I blog regularly on startupmanagement.org/blog or follow me on Twitter, WMougayar, MOUGAYAR.
All right. So that was William Mougayar. Thank you so much for coming on our show.
Thanks, Mayor.